Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
Friends, it's Annette Bybee here, still recovering lawyer, still mom to two teens and a tween, and there is so much going on right now. I always have this really huge stack of stuff that I want to go through, and then I say, oh, I've only got 1 hour. What should I talk about? And I actually ended up talking with a friend yesterday, and it changed what I was going to talk about at the beginning of the show, because I had a friend reach out yesterday, and he said, hey, you know, I've listened to your show, and you've been talking a lot about COVID, and I wanted to add to that conversation. And so he shared with me something that I didn't know. And the reason I've been talking about COVID for the last few weeks a lot is because we have an election coming up not too far from now. And I don't want us to forget what we've come through, what we lived through, the restrictions, the lockdowns, the mandates, all the things that we really want to put behind us, but we cannot forget because it could easily happen again. And honestly, I feel like some of us, I know I feel this way, like we actually have a little PTSD from having come through the last 2 years. And so a lot of us just want to say, let's put it behind us. We're done with that. You know, but then you see someone with a mask. It's like, oh, yeah, there are still people afraid out there. Anyway, what my friend told me was that his brother got the vaccine because he was required to in his profession. He was 34, a hockey player and an avid sportsman, an avid outdoorsman. 2 days after getting the shot, he developed acute pancreatitis. And maybe you're thinking, oh, that's unrelated. That's just a coincidence. That's possible. But another person who received a shot from the same batch also developed pancreatitis, survived it, but now has severe complications. To add insult to injury, this man's family was not allowed to see him or call him in the hospital. And then he passed away. So this is something, you know, completely avoidable. I posted a lot during the time when vaxes were being pushed on all of us. They were mandated by the federal government for the federal employees. We could see that schools were talking about maybe mandating them. A lot of employers were mandating them. And there were so many debates going on social media about it. And what I said was, I'm not anti-vax, I'm anti-mandate. Everyone needs to make the decision for themselves whether or not they are at risk and whether or not the vaccine is something that they think will work for them. And so, you know, I did the calculations for myself. You know, I looked at it and I said, you know, I'm a relatively healthy 50-something year old, and I don't have any comorbidities. I don't really think I need the vaccine. That's a decision I make for myself. Whereas if I was, say, 85 and, you know, maybe a diabetic or had some other comorbidities, I might decide it's worth it for me. But if you're a 34-year-old, healthy person with no comorbidities, why on earth would you want to take this thing? Unless it's either that or lose your job. And that's what a lot of people were faced with. And so to see something like this, where someone just to keep their job took a vaccine and then ended up losing their life, it's hideous. And it's something we do not want to forget. This kind of thing happened. And, you know, there was another story I saw recently about why all the schools actually opened up this year without requiring the vaccine. Because there was a lot of talk about that for a long time, right? These schools that locked down and required masks, and they were doing the 6 feet apart thing. And I subbed during this time period. I'm still subbing. But it was just its own special hell being in the schools last year, because, you know, everything had to be wiped down in between every subject. The kids would go out to recess. Oh, that we quickly wipe down all these tables. Spray, spray, spray. And then the kids would come back in and they would have their masks on and they would be sitting supposedly 6 feet apart. Right. And it was just, it was horrific, especially for someone like me who walks in there knowing the masks aren't doing anything. The distance is ridiculous. The, you know, maybe the spray on the table might have been doing something we thought back then. Now we know, no, it was airborne. It didn't survive on surfaces. But so, you know, it seems like it would have made more sense for the schools to require the vaccine this year, considering how paranoid they were last year and all the lengths they went to try and keep people quote unquote safe. Right. And so there was an article on FEE.org and it talked about why they were not requiring the vaccine. And you would hope it would be because they realized that it wasn't needed in young kids, or you would hope that they would realize that there's a freedom issue here. I mean, underlying all the inconveniences or whether it works or doesn't work, it's the whole freedom issue. You'd think maybe that would be the reason. But no, that really isn't the reason, according to this article. I tend to agree with them. The reason why schools aren't requiring the vaccine is because there have been a lot of young people, especially young men, who've developed myocarditis, and some have died. So what happens if, you know, all these parents go along with it and there's this mass vaccine to all these young kids and teenagers, and even one or two of these kids die of the vaccine? That's bad optics. That's the reason. That's bad optics for the people that would want to force the vaccines, which are usually blue state governors, school boards, that kind of thing. And so that's the reason why you didn't see it, which to me is kind of interesting, because that means that they're acknowledging the fact that kids have died from taking the vaccine, or young people have died. A 34-year-old had died from taking the vaccine, and there was no reason for this healthy 34-year-old to take it. He was at almost zero risk of death. I mean, most of us were almost at zero risk for death. We still are. I mean, it's COVID is still out there. It's much milder now, but it's still out there. And so I wanted to talk about this, and my friend wanted me to bring it up because you don't hear many of these stories told in the media. And we have this election coming, and many of us, especially states like Colorado, where I'm at, we have a governor who is all for mandates, who told us that we were bastards if we weren't wearing masks. We had a Mayor Hancock that was all about locking down businesses. And we had Democrat state legislators who did not even blink an eye at Polis taking over the state, basically, with these emergency orders. And so when you go to vote in November, what you really want to do is look at the people that are running and see, were they in favor of lockdowns and mandates? If so, then we're not voting for that person. Did they actively speak out and take action against any of these mandates? Then yes, I would be more willing to vote for that person. So you need to remember this come November, because I saw a great meme the other day, and it said, within every progressive, there is a totalitarian trying to get out. I screwed that up, but it's something like that. But it's the truth. When you look at the progressive policies, there's always that element of you're going to do what I say because I know better. I'm the smart one here. You're the stupid one. I'm protecting you. I'm going to make your life better for you. You don't see that on the right. Usually the right is more individualistic. Let's make our decisions for ourselves. So the other thing that was interesting is I saw another article that talked about, so Biden came out recently on 60 Minutes a few days ago, and he said that the pandemic was over. It was kind of an off-the-cuff remark, but he said it twice. And so everyone's thinking, yay, the pandemic's over. No more excuses for any emergency actions, funding, nothing. COVID funding should be by the wayside, right? Mandates should be done with, all that. And one of another article I saw made the point that if the pandemic is over, then student loan forgiveness has no justification. Because that was the justification that he was using, was the pandemic. We were in an emergency situation. So you can't have it both ways. You can't say the pandemic is over, because obviously he said that because he wants to take credit for ending the pandemic before the election. But you can't say that and on the other hand say, oh, but we're going to forgive all these student loans because COVID, right? But what's also funny is that after he claimed the pandemic was over twice on 60 Minutes, it was walked back. His comments were walked back by the White House. According to CNN, an administration official told the outlet that the president's comments do not mark a change in policy toward the administration's handling of the virus, and there are no plans to lift the public health emergency. So in other words, don't listen to the president. He's not in charge. He doesn't make the calls here. So just disregard what he said. We're running the show, not him. And so let's see. Ryan P. Williams, president of the Claremont Institute, said, we have a non-president. I think tomorrow when I do my poll, I do daily polls on Facebook. If you want to go to my group, America, Annette on America radio show, Facebook group, go find me. And I conduct polls every day. And I think the one I'm going to conduct tomorrow is going to be about who is really in charge. Because I'm curious, you know, what people think. Obviously, Obama's the big guess, right? And then I would say Jill Biden is a good guess. But I'm curious to see if there are some other ideas. Whenever I put a poll up, if my followers don't think I have enough good options up, they'll throw up their own option, which I always enjoy. Because a lot of times they come up with better ones than I did. So that's probably going to be my poll option for tomorrow. Who's running this country? If when Biden says things like that, we can't take him at his word. No. He doesn't speak for us. He doesn't speak for the White House. He doesn't speak for the administration. So I'm not sure who does. But, you know, the COVID thing, it may go away. I mean, for most of us, for 95% of us, probably it's gone. Unless you walk into a Walmart. For some reason, Walmart shoppers really like the masks. I'm not really sure why, but they tend to. And pilots, if you're a pilot in the Air Force, you still have to wear a mask. One good ruling that we had come down, I think it was either today or yesterday, but the Head Start kids and Head Start teachers no longer have to have the vaccine or wear a mask in those states that have the Head Start program. And so, you know, we're seeing a lot of people, not just our non-president, acknowledge that we no longer, I mean, a lot of us thought we never did, but you can no longer say we are in some kind of an emergency situation. And as I've said before, one of the reasons, COVID is probably the main reason why so many people are doing different things with their kids now. And I'm going to have a guest on here in another minute or so who's going to talk about how to take your kids out of school if you don't want to do this anymore. And before we go to that call, I want to share one happy mom moment. Yesterday, I asked my daughter, because they're all in this charter school here. I've moved them all into a Hillsdale College affiliated school precisely because of COVID and the lockdowns and the masking and the CRT, et cetera, et cetera. And I asked her if they did anything for Constitution Day, because I had seen some posts on Facebook from the school about it, but I hadn't heard anything from my kids. So I asked her, my sixth grader, did you do anything? She said, yeah, we memorized the preamble. I said, go ahead. So she recited it to me, and I have to say that made me feel all warm and fuzzy inside. And so I was really grateful that my kids are in a school that even acknowledges Constitution Day, let alone doing anything about it, because when I've subbed, every year that I've subbed so far, I have not seen even any mention at all about Constitution Day on the day of or the day after. I subbed on Constitution Day this year. Instead, they were having a prize day to reward their kids for going around and begging for money to help the school make up for not having enough students attend. Anyway, all right, so I have on the line Ashley with Task Force Freedom, and she's going to come on and tell us what the process is for taking your kids out of school. Ashley, are you there?
Yes, hello.
Hi, Ashley. How are you?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm good. And I've had you on my show before, and you told me why you were lining up with Task Force Freedom is who you're calling for today, right? First, tell us what Task Force Freedom is for those that don't know.
So Task Force Freedom is a group of people, and we're all working on bringing everything to light, everything that is happening in these public schools, what is happening to the kids. We work on everything, every angle, and just provide support for parents that don't know where to go, how to get help, resources with actual facts in them of what's going on. And so we work with, right now I'm the opt-out form coordinator, so I'm just telling everybody how to opt their kids out of the surveys and the SEL teachings and the critical race theory. We also have another group of people that are working on all the books that are in the schools that have pornography, trying to get those out of schools, out of the libraries completely. And then we also have another group that helps us with board members, how to contact your board members and get answers and get them to do stuff. So we kind of do a little bit of everything. And
that's awesome.
With help.
Because a lot of us, I mean, I was able to get my kids into this charter school, but the only reason I was able to do that is because I went and worked at the school 2 days a week for like 4 months and put my kids on the waiting list. And last I heard, there were 700 kids trying to get into 150 spots. And so that gives you an idea that there are so many of us that have just been desperate for alternatives for our kids. But not everyone, obviously. There were 550 kids that did not get into the school. So those parents have got to find some way to make school better for their kids. And so I'm glad to know that Task Force Freedom is trying to work within the school system for people that don't have that option. You know, like I've thought about homeschooling too, but I'm a single mom. I don't have that option. I can't just stay home and, you know, and frankly, I don't think I could with my oldest. She likes to fight me on everything. I can't imagine trying to get her to actually listen to me in a school setting. But there are so many things that go on in the schools that if you're going to leave your kids there, you can't just walk away and, like in the old days, put them on the bus and say, okay, good luck. You know, I mean, in the old days, you could put them on the bus and then they would come home and you didn't really worry about what they were learning other than, you know, maybe they're not going to get very good grades or they're not going to pay attention. But now we've got all these other things we have to worry about. And you joined up with Task Force Freedom because you had some issues with your own son in high school, right? Or was it middle school?
It was high school. They had they were funded through the district a gay pride week.
Uh-huh. And so what happened with that?
So I called everybody, talked to everybody, and still they promised me I was going to have a sit-down meeting with the teacher that verbally like attacked my son, because my son wore a shirt that said "Stop grooming me," and the teacher walked up to him and said that his shirt was a real dick move. Mm-hmm. And I requested to sit down with this teacher and have him apologize to my son. And they ended up, the superintendent of District 6 got back to me and told me that he refused to meet with me. And when we went to open house this year for the school, I walked into the room and he was sitting there where all the kids felt the paperwork for the open house, made eye contact with me and ran out of the room. So nothing came of it.
I wondered. We never did follow up on that. Has there been any more fallout for your son for basically standing up to the whole LGBTQ agenda?
So he's still standing strong. He still speaks out about it, trying to tell kids, like, you don't have to label yourself. You don't need to make decisions at this age. Like, we just need to focus on being kids and learning how to read, write, do math, get ready because they're about to step out in the world. So he still speaks up quite often with some kids and has discussions.
He's a brave kid.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't know if they're planning another gay pride week, but he has told me that he has a group of kids now that see where he's coming from, and if anything happens, I think it won't just be him this time standing up.
Oh, that's good. That's the funny thing about standing up to bullies is that it just takes one person and then everyone else starts to find their guts and get up as well. So tell us how parents can opt their kids out of these CRT things and the SEL and other things like that that are happening at school.
So if you go on courageisahabit.org, they have a link in there. It's called opt-out data mining. And it will go over explaining how bad these surveys are, how they purposely are set up to make every kid at risk. So with the social emotional learning, every kid, the way they have it, is set up to put them at risk. So that's the way that they're allowed to bring this curriculum, I wouldn't even call it curriculum, theories into the school to try to they are indoctrinating your children into, you know, confusing them. So you would go in there and it goes over everything. And at the very bottom is a form. You just fill in your name, your child's name, you sign it. And there's two options you can do. You want to submit it out of one of the two options. One option is you will email it to the school principal, the vice principal, the superintendent, and the teachers. You want to CC every member of the school board and the district superintendent, and then you want to request like a confirmation that they received the opt-out form. And if you don't hear anything within a couple days, follow back up with them, asking them if they got it and making sure that they are acknowledging that you are opting your kid out of the surveys, the SEL teachings, the critical race. Another option you can do, if you have time, is to go in person and meet with the principal and give them the form.
Yeah, that's even more powerful.
But you want to, after you do that, because you want to get it on paper, you want a paper trail, because this all then becomes public documentation. So after you meet up with them and you hand them the form, make sure you follow up with an email and reattach that opt-out form to it and ask, you know, get the response that they're going to do what you are asking. Because what they don't tell parents is that you have laws that protect you. And you have every right to know what is being taught to your kid, what you don't want taught to your kid. And that's what this form does, is it just opts out of all that, and they have to be 100% transparent with you and truthful of what's going on.
All right, so it's courageisahabit.org, and then you find the opt-out, and then you go to data mining?
Yep, the data mining opt-out form.
Data mining opt-out form. All right, great. And Task Force Freedom also is working towards helping kids find other options besides public school. And where can, it's Kane that kind of runs the show down there. Where can he be reached at?
Kane can be reached at taskforcefreedom@aol.com.
Great. And I'm going to have, tell him I'll have him on again sometime because he's always a hoot and he's fun to have on. So, well, Ashley, I really appreciate you taking what was difficult for your son and turning it into a positive, and you being out there helping other parents to keep their kids safe from some of this stuff that they really just don't need to be exposed to.
Yeah.
So thank you, Ashley, for coming on, and we'll talk again soon.
All right. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Bye. All right. So again, if you didn't catch that, courageisahabit.org, find the data mining opt-out form. I actually got a text from someone with some disturbing images that came out of one of our local high schools here. And I still have not been able to find out, get any kind of context for that. But it was a picture taken in the hallway of the high school, and it had these young men dressed up in nuns' habits, and they had a cross, and they had a guy with his arms outstretched on this cross. And it was obviously not, I mean, I don't know if they were making fun of Catholicism or what. And I heard that the superintendent of the Douglas County School Board is on that, and I don't know what happened with it. Hopefully by the next time I'll get some follow-up for you, but that kind of thing should never, ever, ever, ever happen in a school. It's ridiculous. So anyway, if you missed any of this show, tune in to AM 560 on Sunday night at 9 to hear it in its entirety. If you missed that broadcast, feel free to go to AnnetteTalks.com and find it posted there. You can also listen live on AnnetteTalks.com by clicking on the Listen Live button when the show is airing. Also, join me on Facebook at the Annette on America Radio Show Group. And we'll be right back.
Sunday segment with WJJ. You'll be blessed with gospel music, special guests, and so much more. That's the Sunday segment with WJJ. Don't miss it. Only on 1220 AM KLDC.
That's right. This is WJJ. Join me on Sundays at 3 p.m.
This is Carter Conlon. You know, when I got saved and started reading my Bible, the first thing that started happening to me was I started seeing my character in the light of what God says my character should be. It's like going to a doctor and you look good on the outside until you stand in front of an X-ray machine. Then when you stand there in front of that machine, you start to see the things inside of you that shouldn't be there. That's what the Word of God does. So for example, the Word of God says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. So start there, sir, if you're having trouble in your marriage. Allow the Holy Spirit to remove the selfishness and the lust out of your heart. Ask yourself if you love your wife according to the Scriptures. And if you don't, turn from what you are and let God make you into the man that you should be. That's the way the kingdom of God is. It starts by reading the Word of God and by prayer. It's time to pray.
Dr. Charles Stanley on The Christian Life.
If you have developed patience in your life, there is a sense of quiet stability because you've learned that God is in control of your life and He causes all things to work together for good to those who love Him, to those who are called according to His purpose.
The teaching of Dr. Charles Stanley on In Touch, helping you grow in Christ every day.
In Touch, Monday through Friday at 11 a.m. right here on KLDC 1220 a.m.
For the best in gospel music and gospel ministries, KLDC 1220.
Welcome back. All right, we're going to shift gears here. I'm not going to say I won't come back to COVID because I'm going to be coming back to COVID all the time until November and probably even after that because I can and because it's important. But something else that was kind of funny that came out of the 60 Minutes interview with Biden. Okay, I'm just going to read you this little transcript, this little short excerpt. The interviewer is Pelley. He says, concerning politics, Mr. President, You were elected to the Senate in 1972. You were 29 years old, and in those days, it seemed that the parties worked together to move the country forward. And I think many Americans feel that no longer happens, and in fact, may be impossible now. Biden. Well, I don't think it's possible, but it's changed. What we do today, think about it. It's all personal attacks. It's about motive. It's not about I disagree with you on the subject matter. And secondly, I think it's fair to say that we've not had a president like the last president who has made it all of it so personal. I actually LOL'd on that one because was Biden not there for his last few speeches when he called us semi-fascists? I mean, that seems kind of like a personal attack to me. It really feels like Biden and his administration, whoever's behind him, whoever's the real president, is trying to pit us against each other so that we'll ignore some of the things that are going on, like, inflation being ridiculous. I mean, every time I go to the store, it's like a slap in the face. What? It's like, how did this become more expensive from last Friday when I was here? You know, it used to be you go and the prices would stay about the same. It might fluctuate a little bit here and there. But it just feels like it keeps going up every time I go. And it's like, well, where else can I cut back? There aren't very many more places that I can cut back. And my income is not going up. So I'm in the same jam that most Americans are in. And so instead, we should be thinking about how we're semi-fascist. And we should be fighting each other instead of pointing to the obvious that we're in a recession. Anyway, speaking of that, yesterday the Federal Reserve raised interest rates 0.75 points and says it's not done yet. The interest rate range is now 3 to 3.25%, and new projections show its policy rate will rise to 4.40% by the end of 2022 before topping out at 4.6% next year, according to Reuters. This, of course, has to be done to curb government spending-created inflation. And I saw a meme earlier today, actually, it was a quote from a politician, and I can't remember which politician, but it said that when Biden took office, or since the time that Biden took office, our dollar went from a dollar to 88 cents. So what was worth a dollar just less than 2 years ago is now worth 88 cents, and it sure feels like it. So, all right, and there's a couple things. Let's see, which one do I want to do first? Let's do the Colorado stuff. Hang in there with me, non-Coloradans, because guess what? This is not just going to stay with Colorado. It's not. This is happening all over the country. So the first thing that's interesting, Denver set to give 140 homeless people up to $12,000 in cash as part of basic income program. So you know that the left wants UBI, right? Universal basic income. And that's one of the reasons why inflation is so happy for them, because, well, if Americans can't afford things, the government needs to step in and give them some money, right? Let's pretend like the government did not cause that problem. Pretend like the government doesn't always cause a problem and then come in and make it much worse by saying they're going to solve it. Let's pretend that. All right. I'm ignoring Kevin's texts right now, even though they're funny. One of my listeners likes to text me during the show. All right. So $2 million for a pilot program allocated from American Rescue Plan Act, City of Denver says. More than 140 people experiencing homelessness in Denver will each be provided up to $1,000 in cash a month for up to 1 year as part of a basic income program designed to help lift individuals out of homelessness, the city announced last week. Oh, I'm sure that's exactly what it's going to do. I'm sure that this 1 year will lift these people out of homelessness, because after that year is over, I'm sure they'll have gotten a job and they will be making money. And I'm sure that $1,000 in cash won't go to anything else but rent, right? There will be no alcohol or drugs or anything silly like that. It could never happen with the homeless. The $2 million contract with the Denver Basic Income Project was approved by the City Council and will provide direct cash assistance to more than, okay, this is also very funny, to more than 140 women, transgender, and gender non-conforming individuals and families in shelters. You straight men that are homeless, you're SOL. Sorry. Right now, we're only helping women, transgender, and gender non-conforming individuals. So I'm just wondering how many gender conforming, I guess, individuals will come up right now that are homeless, will hear about this and all of a sudden decide that they are gender non-conforming. Oh, whoa. Yes, everybody knew me as Sam, a dude yesterday, but that was yesterday. Today I'm gender fluid. So give me the $1,000 a month for a year. Yeah, if I were Sam, I would probably be tempted to do that. Because why not? Right? How can you tell with the clothing they're wearing? I see a lot of homeless when I come into the station, and it's always sad to me. And by the way, the ones that I saw, most of them were just regular gender-conforming men. So I should probably stop next time on my way over, stop and talk to them and say, look, you've got to quickly become gender non-conforming right now. Or put on a dress and you're transgender. Because guess what? That's $1,000 cash money in your pocket per month if you do that. All right, just as important as housing and shelter is a regular source of income for those experiencing homelessness, Mayor Michael B. Hancock said, this direct cash assistance will help more than 140 women and families. This just bothers me so much. It can't be just 140 people. No, it's got to be women and families currently in shelters move into stable housing and provide support so they can stay housed while opening space in our shelters to serve more people. And I want, if I were the journalist and I was interviewing the mayor, well, so what about after that, fam, that year is up? You kick them out. They no longer get the money. They're going back into the shelter. What was the point of that? The $2 million was allocated from the American Rescue Plan Act, according to the city, and the contract provides up to $1,000 a month for a year to eligible people currently using the shelter system. The Denver Basic Income Project is an organization that provides direct cash payments to 820 people and families experiencing homelessness. The program will be evaluated by University of Denver Center for Housing and Homelessness Research using a randomized control trial, which will measure housing outcomes, utilization of shelter and other homeless services, improvements in psychological health, and substance use for those who opt in. So in other words, these are going to be guinea pigs. They are going to be using you as a trial. So good luck with that to the homeless people and especially to those gender conforming men. All right. Something else that Colorado's, this is so funny. I saw Governor Polis announce this recently that Colorado will now begin accepting cryptocurrency for tax payments. And he touted that as being so high tech, so tech friendly. Look at us over here accepting money from you. In the form of cryptocurrency. Look at how progressive we are in Colorado. Isn't that awesome? All right. So to the biggest story that I don't think many people are really paying enough attention to. Everyone knows that California has decided to ban the sale of zero emission vehicles by 2035. But what they don't realize is that there are several other states who are probably going to follow suit, Colorado being one of them. So this is an article from the Independence Institute. In 2020, California Governor Gavin Newsom signed an unprecedented executive order banning the sale of new gas-powered cars and trucks after 2035. Notice new. So you're going to see a lot of used cars become worth a lot of money in California. And, you know, some of us may have to drive some old clunkers out to California in 2035 and sell them. Anyway, the order was then kicked to the California Air Resource Board, CARB, a state regulatory agency dedicated to air pollution, to formalize the rules in order to make Newsom's decree a reality. And I have to say, I watched the Zoom call because, of course, it's still unsafe. We can't meet in person in California. It's unsafe. So these CARB members did this Zoom call where they were all voting aye and whatever, and they were just like, yes, enthusiastic, yes, over here, like unsaid but implied. I am saving the world right now. Look at me, people. I can tell you what to do. I'm telling you what to drive, but just ignore that. Just look at me saving the world. That's me over here in California on this little board, along with Gavin Slicky Hair. he's not Slick Willy. We already have Slick Willy. Slicky Gavvy. That's what I want to call him, because I grow to detest that man more every day. And, you know, if it stayed in California, that's one thing. We can watch them do their thing, and then we can laugh at them and point and, ha-ha, look what you did. But guess what? It's not staying there. That's what the story's about. All right. Now, it looks like that reality is finally here. According to the New York Times, California is expected to put into effect on Thursday its sweeping plan to prohibit the sale of new gasoline-powered cars by 2035, a groundbreaking move that could have major effects on the effort to fight climate change and accelerate a global transition toward electric vehicles. The move in and of itself is quite significant, as it makes California the first and only government anywhere in the world to have a complete zero emissions vehicle, or ZEV, I discovered the acronym, requirement on the books. But the biggest impact of the move could come from how other states respond. Back to the Times. The restrictions are important because not only is California the largest auto market in the United States, but more than a dozen other states typically follow California's lead when setting their own auto emission standards. Oh, dear. So we're not just talking about California getting rid of electric vehicles by 2035. This could be as many as 12 more states. One of those states that follows California's auto emission standards is Colorado. As it currently stands, California is the only state in the country allowed to establish their own vehicle emissions regulations. Did you know that? That's why they're doing this nutso thing. Because they're the only state in the country that can do it. Because they're so ginormous, right? But you see Texas not doing this. Anyway, while other states are left either to adopt the California standards or those established by federal officials at the EPA. And on multiple occasions in recent years, Colorado has chosen to follow California's lead. Thanks to a 2019 executive order from Governor Polis, it's funny because Polis and Newsom both have the D in parentheses after their names. That really wasn't necessary to the story. We know who these people are. At subsequent rulemaking from the unelected members of the Air Quality Control Commission. Yes, these are unelected people that are making decisions that are going to affect us profoundly. The Colorado auto industry and local consumers are subject to the whims of California bureaucrats, whether they like it or not. And I'm putting a big pin in this right here. So that I can remember when I have Heidi Ganahl on in a few weeks, this is going to be one of our biggest topics. Because notice how Polis hasn't really said anything about this. And as a matter of fact, recently I read an article that said he was going to sue the EPA because in Colorado, we have not met our benchmarks for emissions. So I believe it's 2023, we are going to have to start buying a richer mix gas. And so that's according to the EPA. And so Polis is saying, no, we're not going to pay that. That's not fair. We have a different situation here, blah, blah, blah. And so you read that and you're like, that doesn't sound like Polis. And then you look at the calendar, you're like, oh, right. We have an election coming up in a few months. So we can't have a governor here in a blue but still kind of purple state who's going to say the same thing that Newsom over there in that ridiculously blue, when they had the chance to get rid of him, they didn't do it, California. And so Polis is not going to, you know, jump up like Newsom and say, oh, guess what? We're going to do this too. We like it. No. He's going to pretend for the next few months to be a reasonable person that's concerned with Colorado and the price of gas. He's going to pretend to do that until November. So anyway, Heidi and I are going to have to talk about that. All right. The state is currently subject to California's previous ZEV standards, which stipulates that auto dealers in the state must make an increasing minimum percentage of ZEV, zero emission vehicle, sales each year, 5% annually by 2023, as part of their light duty fleet. With California now moving beyond its previous standard toward an outright ban on the sale of traditional gas-powered vehicles, Colorado could very well follow suit. Like I said, it's not going to happen before the election, but how much you want to bet that not long after the election, Polis comes out and says something? Colorado Energy Office Executive Director Will Tour has already publicly said that Colorado would consider adopting the California ban once it was finalized. But he won't say that now. He won't say that in October. He won't say it in November, unless it's after the election. He also noted that Colorado officials were collaborating with California regulators throughout the gas vehicle ban's formalization process. Given the state's track record, it seems quite likely that Colorado consumers could be among those in the dozen or so states expected to be subject to the rule shortly. I don't know if people out there know this, because I haven't heard anybody talking about this. 12 states could be following California and outlawing new gas cars. From New York Times, at least 12 other states could potentially adopt the new California zero emissions vehicle mandate relatively soon. Another 5 states, which follow California's broader vehicle pollution reduction program, are expected to adopt the rule in a year or so. If those states follow through, the restrictions on gasoline vehicle sales would apply to about 1/3 of the United States auto market. And we're going to come back to that in a minute. The California model regulatory mandate represents a blunt force instrument where precision measures to address the impediments to widespread EV adoption are called for. Electric vehicles are already beginning to penetrate the market among freely choosing consumers. Mandates are wholly unnecessary and stand only to burden those who either can't afford their premium price tag or whose lifestyle cannot be accommodated by the limitations an electric vehicle brings. And let me add here, farm equipment. For some reason, our government is making war against farmers and requiring, this is already happening, that farm vehicles are going to be required to be electric. And yet, from what I'm hearing, they're not nearly heavy enough to do the job. Their range is very low, and they're very expensive. So why would you want to take a country where the food prices are already very high and food is probably going to become scarce and put more pressure on the farmers? It's almost like they're trying to starve us and trying to force us into a great reset. Something to think about there. All right. Rather than simply banning alternatives to EVs by government fiat, policymakers should allow the EV market to continue to innovate and produce better quality vehicles suitable for the variety of functions currently filled by gas-powered options, farm vehicles, fire engines, at more competitive prices. They should also address the glaring deficiencies in public charging infrastructure, which currently represents the most cited reason for EV skepticism among the public, by opening up the process for building to allow multiple firms to compete over charging station quality. Subsidies and other government incentives aimed at encouraging people to buy electric vehicles have been around for well over a decade, with little success at creating widespread demand for EVs. The only thing to actually make EV demand take off for the first time among the broader public was an automaker with innovative battery technology and a vehicle design that the public was attracted to. Successful electrification of the transportation sector cannot be centrally planned. Let me say this again. For governors and these boards of unelected bureaucrats. Successful electrification of the transportation sector cannot be centrally planned. Colorado policymakers should set aside the subsidies and heavy-handed vehicle bans and instead let free consumers make their own choices in vehicle purchasing. If EV demand is truly there, the market will provide. So, you know, I did a poll in my Facebook group today, or was this from yesterday? But I asked about what my followers thought about what would happen with these electric vehicles. Here we go. So I asked, what will be the result of California's ban on gas cars? And now probable, oh, because that's the best part. Today or yesterday, Slicky Gabby came out and said that diesel trucks are racist. Not even kidding. You have to go and find the article in Daily Caller to believe me. Because, you know, I was driving in here today and I'm like, holy cow, look at all these racist trucks around me. I'm getting triggered. I'm sitting here in my white privilege, so triggered. But yes, that's what he said. So that's the next thing. The next thing to come is that they're going to ban diesel trucks in California. Yeah, there will be no problem there, I'm sure. Not at all. So I asked my listeners what they think will happen with this. First option, the rest of the country will have to follow suit. Zero vote. There will be a patchwork of gas and electric cars throughout the country. 3%. California's gas car ban will crash and burn before 2035 and no other states will try it. 15%. And California's gas car ban will crash and burn before 2035, but Washington, Oregon, and other woke states will still do it. Got 61%. And then Kirk added this last one, California will delay implementation because the grid and other technologies are not ready, but will still declare victory over climate change. I actually really liked that option, and I ended up voting for that myself. That got 19%. Because we know, you know, when I said that there will be a patchwork of gas and electric cars throughout the country, what I was thinking was, you know, if California actually continues with this thing and tries to actually do this by 2035, yeah, it's just going to be chaos, right? There aren't going to be enough charging stations. There's probably not going to be enough gas because the gas stations are going to shut down because there aren't enough customers. And so you're going to have these people trying to figure out where to get gas. The gas prices are probably going to go up because more competition. Less competition. They're going to be able to just charge what they want to. There's only gas every, I don't know, six blocks instead of every two or three. But not enough charging stations. The charges maybe will take too long. I mean, it's going to be just chaos, right? But what I was thinking is that, like this article said, Independence Institute, if this was actually done organically and government stayed the heck away from it, then I think over the years, probably naturally, we would get to a sort of a patchwork where there would be a lot of people with electric vehicles. I mean, I have nothing against them other than, first of all, they're way too expensive. The batteries are not green. I mean, there are articles on how they get the lithium for the batteries and slave labor and all that. And, you know, if you will have an older electric vehicle and you need to replace the battery, it costs you more than it would a new gas-powered car close to it. So there are lots of problems, and I don't know what the charging situation is. I've never looked into it. But, you know, if like, I don't know, 10, 15 years down the line, electric vehicles came down in price and started looking more attractive, I might consider one. And if it could charge, maybe a hybrid. I don't want to be wholly at the mercy of electricity. But, you know, then I might consider one. And maybe I would only use it in the city. I wouldn't use it for my long drives because maybe the range wouldn't be as good as I would want it to be. Because I don't want to stop someplace and charge for however long on a trip. And so I could see that naturally, organically, that it could grow up into a situation where, you know, we figure it out. Maybe there's an electric charging station at every gas station. And there are fewer gas stations, but more charging stations. But we get there naturally. I could see something like that working out because it wouldn't happen before we're ready. We would get the grid ready. So anyway, you need to go and find out if you're one of these states, California, Connecticut, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, New York, New Jersey, Oregon, Rhode Island, Vermont, Colorado, Delaware, Pennsylvania, D.C., Washington. If you're in one of those states, you may be subject to this fairly soon. Or maybe it will just keep getting pushed back and never really happen because it's unrealistic. So with my last few minutes, I just wanted to mention the whole thing we see with the migrants. There have been so many awesome memes on Facebook because of Martha's Vineyard and how they didn't want the migrants there and the signs. I mean, they had those people out of there within 48 hours. They weren't going to have any of that over there. Uh-uh. Not in Martha's Vineyard. They got to keep that place white and wealthy. Unless you're going to mow the lawn, they don't want you there as a migrant. So they got them out of there. And it's just so funny that they were trying to accuse DeSantis of being a trafficker. I'm like, seriously? 50 people. Go down to the border, Martha's Vineyard people. Anyway, this is just in. This is hot off the presses. I can't believe this is happening. This is off one of my favorite, most reliable news sources, the Babylon Bee. AOC tearfully recounts how DeSantis yanked her from her Venezuelan home and human trafficked her to Martha's Vineyard, where she died. Critics of Governor Ron DeSantis are outraged at yet another death that has allegedly occurred thanks to his political exploits. U.S. Representative AOC tearfully recounted how the Florida governor yanked her from her Venezuelan home and human trafficked her to Martha's Vineyard, where she died. Following her martyrdom, AOC expressed hopes that Taylor Swift sing at her funeral. After DeSantis recklessly shuttled 0.0001% of the nation's illegal immigrants to a couple of posh liberal towns, Democratic lawmakers vowed to investigate whether any laws were broken. After finding no laws broken, the lawmakers then proposed a bill specifically aimed at preventing the use of immigrants as political pawns, appropriately named the Inflation Even More Reduction Act. And I got to leave it there because I'm out of time. Go find me on AnnetteTalks.com. Follow me, patronize me, become a sponsor, yada, yada, yada. Thanks for listening to Annette on America, where freedom lovers gather.
Thanks for listening to Annette on America. And join her again next week as she talks all things freedom, all